Let's turn to Matthew chapter 6. If you found it, let's stand together. And I want to read just a few verses with you. And we're not going to be dealing a lot with the context here of the verses, but just some statements. And I love how that when Jesus speaks, he is speaking on a topic, but in that speaking, he will make statements in it that become promises and truths that we can count on. And so I just want to see a few of those statements tonight. Matthew chapter 6, verse 1, take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them, otherwise you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Look at verse 6. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Verse 8. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. After this manner therefore pray ye, our Father, which is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Let's pray. Lord, I pray that you would help us tonight. Lord, enlighten our understanding, as Paul said to the Ephesian church. Lord, that you would open our eyes to the truths here. Lord, if we gain even partially the significance of these statements, we would be overjoyed to know that you are our heavenly Father. And for all the shortcomings that our earthly fathers may have had, Lord, you've never had any shortcomings. And Lord, I pray that you bless this message. Teach us tonight, Lord, I pray. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I love there in verse 1, he's speaking about the topic of giving to the poor and giving alms and these things. And he makes a statement when he gets to this matter of speaking of God. And he speaks of God in a very intimate way. And we would expect that Jesus would call the God Father because of the fact that he's the Son of God. And it makes sense that he would say Father. But he begins opening this up here in the Sermon on the Mount, speaking, and he constantly says, your Father, your Father, your Father. And I believe that's significant because he was trying to let them know that it wasn't just a claim that he had as the Son of God, but something that we have as the sons of God or the children of God, something that we can lay claim to and say, our Father. So I want you to see just a few points here about our Father. First of all, notice in chapter 6 and verse 1, our Father is in heaven. Our Father is in heaven. Now, think about that. Many times you may describe, and I would have to describe and say, well, my dad, he lives in Arkansas, okay? And they'll say, oh, so Arkansas is home to you. Why would they assume that Arkansas would be home to me? Because that's where my father lives. They would understand that I am a native of Arkansas, okay? And they call those Arkansans. Now, that is almost a really bad thing, because in the state of Arkansas, there's a law that you are not allowed to pronounce the name Arkansas as Arkansas, okay? It's one of those old laws, because they didn't want to be associated with Kansas. They didn't want to be the other Kansas, and so it was called Arkansas. Actually, it's an old Indian name, but they didn't want them to be associated with that. But then when you call them Arkansans, that's real close, okay? So that's dangerous ground right there. But my family lives in Arkansas, and that's where I am from. I'm a native of Arkansas because my father lives there. Now, when we think about that, then we would have to say there's significance when we address our father. Look at verse 9, when he spoke of them, of the pattern of prayer. He said, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Can I say, our Father is in heaven? And that means our home is in heaven. Take your Bible and go to John chapter 14 for just a minute. Save your place there. Our home is in heaven because our Father is in heaven. I've spoken at times with Jehovah's Witnesses, and they say, well, Bible never says we're going to heaven, okay? It says that we are going to inherit the earth, and the meek are going to inherit the earth. And I thought, well, okay, except for it does, all right? I'm sorry, it does. Look, if you would, there in John 14, verse 1, let not your heart be troubled, ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. He says, wait a second. In my Father's house, the place where he lives, are many mansions, and I'm going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also. I'm coming to get you, to take you to your final destination. So our Father is in heaven. Take your Bible and go to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. James chapter 1 and verse 7. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom no variableness, neither shadow of turning. He says, hey, everything we have comes down from above. What above? Where is this coming down? It's coming down from heaven. He said, I will open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. What I'm saying to you tonight is that as believers, when we say our Father, which is in heaven, what we're saying is my final destination when this life is over is to spend eternity with my Father, which is in heaven. And so this matter of claiming him as our heavenly Father is to say, that is my final destination. Then turn again in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 6. Not only is our Father in heaven, but our Father is in secret. Our Father is in secret. Look at verse 6. He says, but thou when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret, and the Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Aren't you glad for a personal relationship with our Heavenly Father? Now we could say, well, the Father is high and holy, which he is. He is separated from us, which he is in his holiness. But at the same time, as we call on him, he's saying, I want you to know there is a place of secret and intimate relationship with Almighty God. Now take your Bible once again and go to Psalm chapter 91. Psalm chapter 91. Let your fingers do the walking. So you're not old enough to know what that is. It's okay. Now we let our fingers do the walking on the internet buttons. Anybody still use a phone book? Anybody? All right, there's a few. Good. Keep them in business. Psalm 91, verse 1. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He that dwelleth in the secret place. You know what God's saying is? There is a close and intimate relationship that we can have with Almighty God. In other words, it's not this phrase of saying he is our Father. is in to no way diminish who he is as God. This is not saying, well, we brought him down to our level by calling him our Father. No, rather he is saying we have the opportunity to have a close and personal relationship with God. Now, if you don't have that, I feel sorry for you, because what a wonderful thing it is to be able to get alone with God, to have a secret and intimate relationship with God, to have a time alone that when you come away from it, you're refreshed, you're energized, because God has spoken to you and you know that he is your Father and you are his child, and he will take care of you and he will comfort you and he will meet your needs. This place of secret repose, as the songwriter wrote, that we have with God, he says that is because he's our Father. My wife and I were talking just the other night about personal one-on-one time with parents. And talking about what did you do? What did you have with your parents, and trying to plan for our own children to have that one-on-one time. And my wife said something that just kind of struck me and kind of made me think I need to do better with this. She said, the best times, it seems, to be able to talk openly with your child is when you're in that one-on-one time, where that kid can say, hey, this is my time with dad, or my time with mom, and you get to open up. I can remember my dad getting me in his Chevy Sport van, 1979, I think it was, Chevy Sport van, and he built a wooden rack inside of that and had all of his tools hanging from it. On top, we could slide sheets of plywood in, and then there was all these milk crates and everything of tools along the bottom, and that thing smelt like a driving garage inside. I mean, it just had that greasy wood chip smell on the inside of it. And we'd get in on those old plasticky vinyl seats, and they had cracks in them so you could see the yellow foam through them. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Still going strong. You know, throw a towel over it and you are good to go. And so the towel goes down. We sit in there. My dad has his little scanner radio up in there, and wires running this way and that way, and a speaker up on the dash, and a magnet antenna on top of the rusty top of the van, and down we go driving to chase some trains, and to sit by the railroad track. And I still don't know exactly what a squelch knob is for, but I'd be sitting there playing with the squelch knob on that and scanning, and then it would come over the radio, hot box detector, milepost 431. No defects, no defects. You know, when you're a train watcher, you're like, all right, that's cool. I don't know why that's cool, but that's cool. Or maybe they would have a hot box and the axle would be hot and they'd stop the train. We're rushing over there to see the train stop and then take off again. I mean, we were excited about that. You say, why in the world did you even care? Here's why. That was my alone time with my dad. That's when I got to have those discussions and ask those things. And there was nobody else there to say, that's a dumb question. There was nobody there to, quote unquote, as they say in this modern age, judge me, okay? I could just be who I was before my dad. And can I say, this is the relationship that we can have with God when we have that secret time, that place where we get to meet with him and enjoy that intimate relationship. Now he says, hey, listen, don't worry about what people think. Don't worry about what people see of you. You need to learn that your Father knows who you really are. He knows your true motivations. He says, hey, when you go to pray, okay, go to your Father, which is in secret. And here's the next phrase. And your Father, which what? Seeth in secret. He said, what does that mean? Well, that means he can see what others cannot. He sees in your heart. You know, this time is not only an intimate time, but it's a refining time when God looks into our heart and he knows our true motivations and he sees who we truly are. He can see through the facade that we put on. And God said, hey, listen, don't stand up and pray in front of people to try to get their attention and to put on a false front. He said, go to your Father, which is in secret, because he sees your true heart. He sees who you really are. And as you have that intimate relationship with him, so it is also a refining relationship. He said, your Father, which is in secret, he sees in secret. He sees what others do not see. You know, sometimes we think of that as a refining time, but it also is a time when we know, hey, God knows my true heart, that I truly love him, that I truly desire to serve him. And maybe I've been misjudged, or maybe people have treated me wrongfully, or maybe they don't understand what I truly want to do for God, but I'm thankful that I have a heavenly Father who makes no mistake when he looks at my heart and he judges me accurately, and he knows who I truly am, and I never have a worry that I stand before God naked before him and have him misjudge me. What a wonderful relationship we have with God. What a wonderful thing to know that we can come before God and he sees us in secret. You know what's even better about this? Is what God sees in secret, he blesses openly. You ever have a secret and you can't talk about it? Maybe you came into a little bit of money and you can't say how you got it. I mean, not because you stole it, okay? Let's be clear here. You gave a gift and you didn't feel it was appropriate, but it's a blessing that people, someone says, hey, that's a nice car that you got. Yeah, oh man, it's just a blessing. And something that God has done for you that maybe others would not understand. Sometimes you almost feel bad to say, I got a bonus, because someone's going to be like, oh, it must be nice. So you kind of leave it off. But God has blessed. And because of that personal relationship, God says, hey, my blessings won't be a secret. The relationship that I have with you will be in secret, but my blessings will not be in secret. He said, I'm going to reward you openly. What a wonderful relationship we have. We're able to say, our Father is in heaven, therefore my home is there. I'm just in this world passing through. I'm just a sojourner, a pilgrim in this world. But truly, my home is in heaven because my Father's in heaven. And then I have a relationship with him that is in secret. Then thirdly, I like this one. Verse 8, be not therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. Finally, our Father knows. He knows. You see, there's something about being God. There's just this matter that Jesus Christ, while he walked this earth, knew too much to be a man. Have you ever noticed that? He just knew too much. I'm not talking about random scientific facts, okay? I'm talking about he would know what they were thinking. He would know where they've been. He sees them when they couldn't be seen, when they thought they were doing something in secret. I mean, he talks to Zacchaeus, and Zacchaeus probably thinks, he sent somebody out to stalk me. This guy knows me. He's a little short tax collector in a tree. He knows me. And when we come to this matter of divine knowledge, it's wonderful to know that our Father knows. Our Father knows. Now I'll let you know, as pastor, I may not know what you're going through. I could say the same for you. You may not know what I'm going through. Sometimes we're under a burden and it's not something we feel that we can voice. But aren't you glad? He already knows. He already knows. There's nothing that is beyond his view. There's nothing that is beyond his ability to see. And so when you're having that need, you ever have one of those needs that's just lousy? You know, just you're thinking, this is just dumb. I just hate, you know, can't pay that bill. How long is it going to be until I can just say, hey, all the bills are taken care of? Have you ever felt that way? Like, you know, it's just simple. I just want to be able to pay the bills and be a normal American, you know. And times when we face those things, or, you know, your car has issues, and you're like, how many cars am I going to have that just decide they're gonna have issues? You know, I'm not a mechanic. I don't know all these things. And somebody told me this week they bought a used car. They're all excited about it, and it sprung a leak of the radiator on the way home. You know, that sounds about like what I would have happen to me, okay? So here they are. By the way, they didn't use the Barzleaks product. I was disappointed, all right? Barzleaks, everybody, all right. Now, when it comes down to this matter of knowing that he knows, the first part about that is so wonderful is that we're not going through it alone. God already knows. You ever feel like you just need someone to share it with so that somebody besides you cares about it? Somebody besides you is thinking about it? Somebody besides you is doing something about it? But think of the one who we're partnered with. Think of the one who we can say, hey, he knows. It's not just the guy down the street. It's not just our coworker. It's not just a fellow family member. But he says, hey, the one that knows is our Father. He says, hey, he knows. Matter of fact, he knows what you have need of before you ask him. He knows. You say, well, you know, I know God knows generally what I need, but I don't know if he takes specific interest in me. Now, I've met a good number of Christians that have a bit of a self-esteem problem, maybe even because of an earthly father who mistreated them, or an earthly husband, or mother, or brother. And someone in here might be going, he's talking about me. The fact is, there's probably 10 or 12 in here, and each one's going, it's me. He's talking about me from the pulpit, okay? There's multiple numbers of people who have had that, and they feel like there's something wrong with them because of the way that they have been treated. Now, can I tell you, in all of this, he says, I take a special interest in you. Look at verse 26. Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? You know what he's saying here? Hey, listen, if I take care of the smallest bird in the air, if I take care of the lilies of the field, it's like he's saying, I'm trying to prove to you what I've already said. I take a personal interest in your life. I know what you're going through, and it means something to me. You may say, no, I think God cares, but I don't know if he really cares that specifically. One time I was standing out on the golf course, and I was playing with some guys, and I said, boy, I just prayed that we'd have a great day out here. And one of the guys said, God doesn't care about our golf game, okay? God cares about it, but he doesn't care about our golf game. I said, you know, if I really believed that, I wouldn't come out and play golf. I really wouldn't. You think there's like large sections of my life? Well, clocking out here, God, I'm going to play 4.5 hours of golf. I know in that time, you don't care about me. I said, I believe he cares about my golf game. He said, you think God's going to make you a good golfer? Well, I didn't pray for that, but I prayed for a good time of fellowship and that I wouldn't hurt myself and that it would be relaxing, because sometimes golf is not at all relaxing, okay? Not sure who invented this sport, but I got sucked into it by my father-in-law. Now I'm stuck, you know? Now I've got that little itch to go hit the little white sphere. I mean, the thing, and I pray for a good time. He say, why would you pray for that? Because I know my Father cares about everything. There's not anything that he says, no, I'm not interested in that. You're on your own in this one. You see, our Father cares about us. It says that he knows what we need, and he knows before we ask. He didn't say, don't ask because I know. He's just saying, hey, by the way, you're not filling me in on your problems when you ask me. You're not telling me what happened in your life. God, don't you know? Now, that's sometimes how we feel. And I'm glad that when David prayed that way, it was recorded. God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you left me alone? What's going on? And we feel that way. But the truth that we need to remind ourselves, even when we feel that way, is this. He has not left us alone. He already knows. He is sitting waiting for us to come and ask that he might answer. My pastor used to say, he's sitting at the corner waiting for you. And that's what he's doing. He's just saying, hey, I already know what you need. We're not coming to God and saying, God, do you know what's going on? Oh, really? No, please let me know. We're saying, God, this is what I'm asking for. And he says he'll answer. Go to chapter 7. Jesus addresses it again in Matthew chapter 7. Chapter 7, verse 7, ask and it shall be given you, seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, for everyone that asketh what? Receiveth. Well, that'd be pretty dumb not to ask if everyone that asketh receiveth, okay? If everyone that asks receives, because I know the F on the end is hard to understand, okay? So I'll just say it, asks. Receives. All right. Some people say it's so hard to understand. I'm not sure what part it is. Okay. Everyone that asketh, receiveth. Better. All right. Just making it understandable. Like, do you say blessed or blessed? All right. Just throwing that out there. Everyone. No. Well. The people that are important to God. You ever felt that way? Ever been in a class and you feel like some of the kids are more important to the teacher than others? Ever been there? And sometimes it's true. We had a classroom that I worked in, and they say, teacher's pet, and the teacher would put her arm around a couple of girls and say, yep, these are my pets. I'm like, not a good idea. Really not a good idea. These kids could get away with murder. I think they actually did. I'm not sure. Some pretty bad things. Stole from the school. And she was saying, these are my pets. And you know what that immediately does for another child is they say, hey, I'm not as important to that teacher. And so I'm not even going to ask because I know they don't really care about me. But the Bible says of the Father, he says, everyone that asketh receiveth. And he, that is anyone that seeks, finds. And to him that knocks, it shall be opened. He says, hey, I'm just waiting till you get here and ask. I already know about it and I want to do something about it. All I'm saying is, just ask. Just ask. You say, why would God have us ask? Well, why do you have your children ask? You know, they come in, they start eating things out of the fridge. Have you ever had that problem? It's like, that was for something else. Don't eat that. What's going on? They take the refrigerator back to their bedroom. Teenage boys, you know, got to chain the fridge down, not even just chain it shut, you got to chain it down. Sometimes we're like, just ask. I would give it to you, but I want you to ask. I want you to come to me and say, hey, I'm hungry. And I can tell you, you need yogurt, not a fistful of candy. Aren't you glad God gives us what we need? The Bible says he knows what we have need of. And when we ask him, he doesn't give us everything we might want, but he gives us what we need. So when we come to him, he says, I know what you need. And you may say, God, this is what I want. And God gives you something else. You say, well, I guess this is the answer to prayer. That's what you need. And God knows it. And he gives. And he says, hey, just come and ask. Verse 9, Matthew 7, 9. Or what man is there of you whom if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent or a snake? If ye then, being evil, having sin nature, know how to give good gifts unto your children. Think about that. He's saying if your kid asks you for bread, you don't give him a stone. Okay, let's modernize that a little bit, okay? If your kid asks you for a hamburger, okay? They say, hey, I would like a hamburger. You don't go to the shop, pick up a whole block of wood, and say, here you go, eat this. And you say, what? Of course not. Now take that of course not in your mind right now that says, why would he even do that? Hey, I was wondering, can I get some meat? I'd like a tuna fish sandwich. Well, you pull the snake out. Why don't you eat this? He says, it's almost ludicrous to think anybody would do that. It's ludicrous to say, that's just ridiculous. You know what God's saying? Why do you treat me like I'm ridiculous? Why do you treat me like I would do that to you? I just prayed and prayed and God just hasn't done anything. Really? That's ridiculous. I'm sorry. It's ridiculous to think that God is not doing as good as even a parent with a sinful nature. That's just ridiculous. And unless you serve a different God, then what God is doing is for your good. You say, well, I've waited a long time. Then God wants you to wait. He's doing it for your good. Look at the next verse, or I guess the continuation of that verse. He says, if you know how, listen to this, how much more shall your Father which is in heaven, there's that phrase again, give good things to them that ask him. Remember growing up, and my dad, we did construction, and my dad would say, hey, we need to saw this, and he'd pull out his power saw, had a worm drive skill saw, left side blade, for those who care, all right? And he'd pull that thing out, and whew, that was awesome. That thing fired up, sound like a motorcycle. You know, I was like, yeah, that's a manly saw. I go to put it away, you know, it was already unplugged, and I couldn't hardly carry the thing over there. But one day I decided, hey, I want to cut the wood too. You know, Dad, can you teach me how? You know, I was a spindly 9-year-old. Can you teach me how to cut it? He's like, sure, sure. And he walked over to the van, and he got a handsaw. I was offended. I was expecting him to come back with that circular saw, you know, and I got to be a real man. He said, here you go. It's pretty sharp. Be careful not to cut yourself. And I'm like, whatever. I didn't cut myself. Got over there with that saw. I didn't cut myself. Matter of fact, I didn't cut much anything. I sat over there. I know how to do it. I'm like 150 times, and I'm still not even making much of a dent in the wood. I said, I don't think this saw is very sharp. He said, oh, let me see that. I'm not kidding. I don't know how my dad did this. I'm not sure if I can do it. But about 8 passes, he had the 2x4 cut. He went, quick, 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 boom. It was gone. I was like, wow. Wow. I was like, give me that thing back. 150 more times. I don't know what I'm doing. Now, how many of you say he was smart to give me the handsaw, seeing that I had not even an idea how to run it, than to give me the power saw? I was not ready for the power saw. You know what we're always asking God for? Give me the power saw! And he goes, well, here you go. You're like, oh, this is not what I asked for. He said, I don't need to give you that. I was speaking with a man who had one of those worm drive saws, and we were talking about it, and I told him that my uncle used to wire the guard open, and they'd be up on the 2-story houses, and he'd get down there on the rafter tails, and they'd already have them marked, and he would grab and he would take his saw and cut them off 2 stories, step from one to the other, and he'd cut those rafter tails off. And he said, yeah, that'd be a good idea until that thing kicks up and gets you. And I said, oh, what are you talking about? And he said they had a guy who had one of these saws wired back like that, and he went to cut a header. And when you cut the headers, a pressure will come and it'll squeeze the saw. And when it did, that saw being wired open kicked back and landed on him. They literally said they had to pull his shirt together to put his guts back in so they could get him to the hospital. All of a sudden when he said that, I recalled that time when I was hoping to use that big worm drive saw. Now the thing wasn't wired open, but I was just thinking, my dad was very wise to know what I had need of. He knew what I needed, and when he gave a gift to me, when he gave me something that I asked for, he gave it in such a way that it would be a blessing to me. So he'd come out there and he'd say, "How you doing?" I finally figured out, you got to turn the thing up at an angle at least. I'm just running it back and forth, you know, over and over again. I finally got to where, after, you know, hundreds and hundreds of tries, I could saw it pretty good with a handsaw. I started saying, "This thing isn't sharp." And he said, "Okay, we'll sharpen it." And he'd take the kerf on it and then open it up a little bit. And we'd get out there and we could really saw with that handsaw. And then one day, I can remember him pulling out the skill saw. And now I had a real respect for it. He had helped me understand my lack. Can I tell you, just because you don't have everything that you've asked God for, he may have given you exactly what you asked for in the way that you can receive it, and it will be beneficial and helpful for you. Don't think God doesn't know that your heavenly Father isn't paying attention to you because he hasn't answered everything in the time or in the way that you expected it. He says, "Our Father knows what we have need of, and if we ask him, we will receive. And if our earthly fathers know better than to give us something ridiculous, then surely our heavenly Father is much more understanding of what we need than even our earthly fathers." I love donuts. Anybody else in here love donuts? I love donuts. I give my kids donuts because I want to eat them myself and I don't want to be judged. "Let's go to the donut shop." "Okay, Daddy." I'm over there eating, you know, donut. I'm like, "These are great, aren't they, kids? We do these donuts. We don't take Mom, you know, she probably knows better." Like those donuts. I don't think donuts have any value at all, do they? Is there anything positive that, I mean, and now with this gluten rage, I mean, they're all out. They were already fried. They were already covered in sugar. Now they're full of gluten. They're little toxic bombs. But if you laid one in front of me, I'd eat it. Knowing all that, I'd eat it. So I need some restraint. I need someone to hold me back from the donuts. It's interesting that they're shaped, you know, like this, kind of like your midriff is when you eat them. I said to somebody yesterday, I said, "You know, it'd be difficult for me to work in a donut shop because I'd have trouble not, you know, eating up the inventory." And he said, his response to me was, "Yeah, I wouldn't be trying to stop. I would just be going ahead and doing it." That's kind of how I feel about donuts. You know, the truth is, we don't always know what is best for us. And if we know it, we still at times will do what we know is not best for us. But here's one thing for sure, he knows what is best for us. I'm having trouble describing it. Let me try one more time. It's like we can go asking for the wrong things, and he'll give us the right things because he is an all-wise Father. We can go not even knowing what we need, thinking, "This is what I need. I need a donut." And instead, my wife gives me a bagel. Now, you know what? I've learned bagels are pretty good. Well, of course, if you slather them with enough cream cheese, they are. Okay, there we go again. But you know what? We want a donut, and God knows we need a bagel. He says, "Here's what you actually need." "Well, that's not what I asked for." "I know, but you asked, and now you're receiving, and what you're receiving is what is good for you. And this is something that you can enjoy, and it will be good for you in time to come." I'm just saying, to question his motivation is simply to say this: our heavenly Father doesn't even know as much as our earthly father. Let me say, that's just absolutely not true. Our heavenly Father, he says, much more. Much more. If we understand it, God understands it much more. So I hope you'll leave this Father's Day thinking, "Hey, my heavenly Father. My heavenly Father, he knows. My heavenly Father is in secret, but he rewards me openly. And my heavenly Father is in heaven, and he's going to take me there. I'm just here for a time. I have a heavenly Father. Do you? Can you say, God is my Father? Well, you can if you came to him through Jesus Christ the Son. There's only one way to the Father. It's through Jesus Christ. And if you have made Christ your Savior, if you've called on him for salvation, you're a child of God, and he is your Father. What a wonderful thing. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to really see the significance of having a heavenly Father.